Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today it is DR1202 day. That is, it is the 12th day of the second month, which you write in the UK at least as 1202, which is Rick's number, 1202. So it is Happy Rick Day. So to celebrate, I would have gone up the DR, but I'm pretty sure everybody's sick of looking at the DR at the moment. So instead, we're going to be going along the West Somerset Railway. And in fact, I actually have a modified version of Rick. I know I said that wrong. A modified version of Rick, which allows him to actually be turned on a turntable. Because in reality, he would fit on a 70-foot turntable, even with his larger tender. But because of the overhang and the way that TS works, he doesn't normally fit on a turntable. But I made it so that he can actually fit on a turntable, and he also has his smaller tender for his visit to other railways anyway. And as you can see, he's got his Rick nameplates on his side with his smoke box rather than down on his running plate. So I don't know how many people are about, don't know how many people care, don't know how many people are watching, but I hope you guys enjoy this little run. And I hopefully might have some people joining me in the call later on, but I will have to wait and see. So where are we? We are at Bishop's Lydiard on the West Somerset. We've got an 8-coach train, and as you can see, we've got Rick and his teeny tender. Now, there is one slight disadvantage of using this modification to him to make him, basically the game thinks he's a lot shorter, and that is that the camera for the cab is a bit further back. But to be fair, that gives us a wide angle lens of Rick's cab. So we're getting a slightly different look today. Also, I did notice it gives me a better look at his valve gear as we're going along. So, and then down there, that's awful, because of the camera, and because of the platform. So, yeah, we're going to go and have a go along the West Somerset today, mainly just to celebrate Rick's sort of birthday, because in DDJP 77C universe style whatevers, he would have been built on, well, completed, erected, I suppose, on the 12th of the 2nd, 1980. So, we're going to go with that. So, without further ado, and without further haste, let's leave Bishop's Lydiard with our, what you could call a small passenger train. Perfect timing, he blew off as we leave the station. Fantastic. I will try and have a periodic look at the chat as we're going along, but yeah. Someone's asked if Rick's a new engine for the DR. He will be eventually, but not yet. I'm going to ignore the comment above it because, yeah. So unfortunately, not much to really say at the moment. People are downstairs doing other things, so unfortunately, I'm kind of on my own up here. But that's all right. We can hopefully get this drive all right, and hopefully, I'll be able to turn Rick at the other end. Unfortunately, it's going to be a long run-round procedure because I think we're going into... let me have a look at the map, actually. Yeah, we're going into the Minehand main platform, so I'm going to have to run off the train, then go into the yard, and then attempt to turn him on the Turny McTurntable, with any luck. We shall see how this goes. But now, it's time to climb up to Crocombe Heathfield. So I'm going to stand here, and we're going to watch the valve gear go round and round. With his little tiny tender as well. King Edward has asked, I wonder what the axle loading on Rick would be. Well, because he's got more axles, he's actually got a slightly better axle load than Barry. So despite being significantly bigger and a bit heavier, his axle loading's actually all right. So, I've been joined by Mr. Chris Rasmussen. Hello, Mr. Chris Rasmussen.
Hello.
Right?
I see you're driving Rick.
Am I? Am I?
Happy Dick Ray. I mean, Rick Day.
Fuck, you did the joke before I could do it. God damn it. Rick Day, Prick Day, Dick Ray, you know, make as it what you will.
Happy Rail Going Sea Cucumber Day.
Rail Going Sea Cucumber, is that what he is?
Uh-huh.
Why?
He's mean, he's green, and he's on rails. And he's looks like a cucumber.
And I think he drinks naked energy drinks as well.
Yeah. I'm gonna attempt my hardest not to go to NSFW. I'm a bit head waved, so.
Oh yeah, you're in that weird sort of thing today, aren't you?
State.
Yeah, yeah. You're a bit fudged.
Yeah.
That's all right, I suppose.
I can help be your chat monitor and ask questions that would actually make sense to ask.
Thank you. That means I can concentrate on driving. Good.
Exactly.
Yay!
Someone said. Well, there are two things here. Who would win, Barry or Rick in a tug of war?
Rick. why ask that question? I mean, you can
just
see.
Just easy.
Well, I mean, you can just see from him, like, he's big. He's got an extra cylinder to Barry anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, well, I mean, fucking look at him, he's hench. He's all neck. He hasn't even got a neck, he's just hench.
True. Here comes a bottleneck question that I have no idea how to answer, so it's on you.
Okay.
Why is the radius rod moving separate from the expansion link?
Radius rod and expansion link. Are they on about at the front?
I guess.
Don't ask me. Ask Chris Wilson. He built it. Don't look at me. Could also be because he's a three-cylinder machine as well. So valve timing, I don't know.
Bears. This is basically going to turn into a Q&A about Rick.
Yeah. What is Rick? He is a train. What does he do? He pulls trains.
No, it's more like someone's asking, what's the main inspiration behind Rick? Like, the loco, I'm guessing.
Oh, well, that's easy. Hercules and Samson on the Romney Hyde and Dymchurch Railway, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's... Mm-hmm. Oh, God. Well, I suppose his influence as well is kind of the big LNER engines as well. That's why he looks so much like an LNER engine.
Yeah. Which is funny, seeing as you're a Southern man.
And I constantly talk about my distaste for the LNER.
Yeah. What class is Rick? He's a DR1202 mountain class.
Yep, that basically sums it up.
That's it.
That's just it. That just sums him up.
That's it, folks. Da 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 da
da. Da 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 da. I mean, that is true, though. Like, he hasn't really got a class. He literally is just his own class of engine. Like, the original DR1202 was just literally called, like, it was just known as the 1202 class.
Yeah.
So Rick is technically speaking then a 1202 class. I mean, you could call him you could literally just call him the DR Mountain class if you want, but officially he is the 1202 class. That is literally just his designation.
Fair. Also, I have a question here that I can answer so easily.
Have question?
Yeah. Someone's asking, is Rick the railway version of the Hulk? Yes, he can literally pull the skin off a yogurt.
He literally has pulled the skin off a yogurt before.
It's incredible.
He is...
Never have we seen someone pull the skin of a yogurt so nonchalantly.
Which is really interesting, actually, because we were watching Chris Wilson testing out the cathedral, weren't we, on, what's it called, on Stainmore?
West of England.
He was doing it on Stainmore. The one I saw him doing, it was on Stainmore, right? And yeah. I just found it really funny how the cathedral can, like, literally bark up the bank from Penrith up to Shap at, like, 60-odd miles an hour. And Rick can plod up there at like 50 with the same load. Which, yeah. I suppose it means that the cathedral is powerful and fast.
Yeah.
But then again, I don't think Rick was ever designed to go that fast anyway, so... But
I think the thing is as well, when it comes to that test, remember, the cathedral picked up a lot more speed than Rick did.
Yes, that is true. So it literally
momentum.
Romped up the bank, yeah.
A momentum. He while is... Rick has raw power. Like, he didn't falter.
Hey, no, oh, no, he didn't stall or anything. Speed. No, he just plodded. That's what he does.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to quick fire answer some of these things.
Okay, go on.
What power class is Rick Hench F?
Yeah, he's just Hench.
Hench F.
I think the joke won't be put him in 10MT if he was in BR livery because he's...
Yeah.
Because he's got the mid-sized driving wheels, he technically speaking could be classed as a mixed traffic engine. But yeah. He's just powerful. He hasn't really got a power classification. Let me put it this way. A King is about 40,000 pounds of force. A 9F is about what? Something like 44,000 pounds of force?
44, 45, I think.
Yeah. Rick is 55,000 pounds of force.
Yeah.
So he is outside of... He's a bit like Bertha in that respect. Bertha was very powerful but never had a... Never had a power classification. Anyway, Cameron, with the quickfire questions?
Well, one deleted, so I don't remember it. In your universe, doesn't that make Rick the strongest engine in the country? Yes.
Yes. After the LMS Garrett and the... After the U1 Garrett and the LMS Garretts, he is the third most powerful that would have existed. However, he is the most powerful in preservation. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense. Like, you know, because there's no LMS Garretts in Prez. Unless I change my mind if someone does one. And the U1 Garrett obviously might... I don't know if someone can ever do the U1 Garrett, but we'll see. That'd be nice.
I'll do U1.
Cheeky.
Yeah, that's about it on the questions, really, so far. So let's just sit back and chill and watch Rick plod up the line.
Plod. He just PC plod. Get some water in the boiler.
And, by the way, just to quickly steal your attention for a sec, Tom.
Uh-huh.
You know how you said good luck on climbing hills on,
Oh, right, I did say that. Yeah, because you're driving the Light Pacifics at the moment, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm learning how to drive the Light Pacifics. I'm testing them.
Nice.
I just crested Woodhead at 50.
Very good.
So, Jordans, eat your heart out.
Why, did Jordan say you can do it well?
No, Jordan said I could never, ever, ever fucking...
Oh, he was the one who was going on about you driving advanced locos, wasn't he? I know you can drive advanced locos, and should you prefer to do simple locos, because they're just nice for sitting around and plodding on. Also, if anybody's noticed the absolutely hilarious thing about Rick and his smaller tender, you can see in the stream right now how much thinner the fucking tender is to Rick. His normal tender is the right width, but the smaller tender is a lot shorter, thinner. It's a bit like an LMS crab.
Hey, Tom.
Hello.
Brr, 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 brr. Let's see. Under LMS classification, Rick would have been an 11F. Mad.
Holy shitting Nora.
Yeah.
AKA Hench.
Yeah. Is Rick Day a national holiday? Yes, you're allowed to have one stroke a day when it's Rick Day.
When it's Rick Day, what you're allowed to do is you're allowed to praise our Lord and Saviour, Sir Mr. Character Smash, for building him.
Yeah.
Or Chris Wilson, if you want to talk about real world.
True.
Problem is, I've got him at the moment, like, his textures have the quartered buffers, right? But once he had been in service for, like, a little while in this livery... He'll go back to having grubby buffers again. Or I could just give him quartered buffers on every single version of him. That'd be nice.
That could work.
Could do. No, except on the filthy liveries.
Let's see. I'd have no idea where this is.
Right.
I was just saying, by the way, we're on West Somerset. Someone asked that.
Yeah, we're on the West Somerset Railway. Oh, hang on. I just realised something that's up here.
What?
Broad gauge track. I think that's meant to be broad gauge, at least.
Why fuck me?
Because I think it's because this line was built at broad gauge. Oh my god, we stopped
was
a bit short.
Was it?
Yes, it was. So it fit Rick. Oh, mate, can you imagine Rick in broad gauge? He would literally be wide Rick.
Don't do that. Don't give me hope.
Happy Rick Day.
Gwion, hello.
Also, Rick and broad gauge would be very tasty.
I love how Gwion came in because we said that. I love it. He would indeed be very, very thick.
Mm-hmm. The thick boy.
He is a very thick boy, but he's a beautiful boy. I love him. I love him.
So which route are we running today?
Oh my West fucking Christ, West Somerset!
I literally just said on the stream. You catch the broad gauge part, but you don't catch the part where I say what route we're on.
Yeah.
Wait, is that sign that says way out? Yeah, go find one.
And he yeeted himself.
God, can you see, like, I know I said this a minute, but you can really see in this, like, how thin the ROD tender is compared to Rick.
I was just about to say, yeah, the ROD tender.
Because Rick built to, like, a massive loading gauge. Because obviously the DR is a big loading gauge.
It's fat.
Someone just asked, am I late? Hello?
Yes.
This started stream 15 minutes ago. I count that as late, but Tom didn't put like a fucking notification thing on, so technically no.
I just did it sort of
spontaneous.
You know, yeah, spontaneously. Look at that valve gear. Maybe Gwyn can explain actually.
Yeah.
Someone was asking about the expansion link and the what you call it, whatever you call it. I don't fucking know. These bits, they move out of synchronization.
It's the valve timings.
Yeah, that's what I said.
It's because there's
it's got a third cylinder as well.
Well, that's not to do with the third cylinder because it'll have its own eccentric and timing valve within the frames.
Ah, okay.
Each cylinder has a set of because your valve timings are based on your cutoff and things like that, like. The distance, the stroke of the eccentric is based off that. So yeah, that's what it's all there for. It's like valves, like the timing belt on a car is used to time all the valves opening and closing on a car when fuel goes in, air comes in, all that stuff.
Right.
Welcome to Gwion's TED Talk.
Here, Gwion's TED Talk.
But even then, I still don't have a clue how it works. I do, but I don't know. On a
It's funny, I literally just turned you up because you were too quiet. Now I've turned you up, you're now too loud.
I'm too loud now.
Yeah, that better.
Anyway.
Purple is the only colour for a really useful engine. Isn't that right, Rick? Please never paint me purple, sir.
Is Rick using a 300 PSI boiler or the
275,
sorry.
Yeah, because the original loco had 300 PSI, this one is 275. Which is still insane for a parallel boiler. He's very similar to what they did with LMS Fury, because that had a parallel boiler, but that was like prepped to 250 odd, and then like 900 odd, and then 1000 something odd. Mental.
Someone just said, and I know I have an answer for this, and I know you do too, Tom.
Mm-hmm.
Someone said, Rick was primarily made for freight, but with the pilot wheels and trailing, wouldn't that make him a decent passenger locomotive?
Yes. That's why he, technically speaking, makes traffic.
Yeah. And not only that, but he's
in the heritage.
Built at a heritage railway.
Yep. For heritage passenger trains, yes.
That are primarily passenger orientated.
Yep.
So, yeah.
The basic idea is that Rick is it's going to be mentioned in like in the season he airs in, because spoiler alert, he doesn't appear until he right. Okay, let me explain. He does appear in season 10, but not like this. And his actual appearances won't start until proper season 12. So unfortunately, you're going to have to wait until season 12 for that. But one of the ideas is that one of the engines are basically going to turn around and say. That Rick is nothing more than a showpiece, as in he's like he doesn't serve a function, he doesn't serve a purpose.
Oh, a vanity project.
Yeah, a vanity project, that's it. And I think that's kind of a sad thing to say about it, because he's representing something that doesn't exist anymore. However, he has, technically speaking, been built for a purpose, which is he is primarily for passenger work. He only runs good trains as, as demonstration, because let's face it, the DR doesn't run freight trains anymore, mainly passenger trains, so that's the main reason he built, you know, to bolster the fleet, and he's also just, you know, he's there for showboating, of course, but I like to think of Rick as being a lot more, when he's built, he's going to be just basically incredibly humble, and he's going to be really innocent as well, like, He doesn't like the fact that he's going to be, you know, the centre of attention all the time, and he'd much rather be not the centre of attention because he feels like he takes the limelight away from other engines, and he doesn't like that.
Yeah.
So an interesting comment here, the season 12, episode 2.
Yes, that is exactly when Rick would appear.
People and that should be on the 12th of the 2nd?
I'm hoping so. 12th of the 2nd, 2023, we're looking.
Sweet.
Also, Rick wins all races.
Yes.
Basically, well, no, not always. Sometimes he derailed because his, do you know what the funny thing is? Rick is quite solid. Nintendo, on the other hand, is very prone to derailing because it's got a higher centre of gravity.
No, Tom. Rick wins all races.
Does he?
Yes.
Is this something you've decided?
It's been decided by committee.
Yeah, well, wait until the cathedral comes out. He'll loom to that. And he'll also, yeah, it'll literally be like you've got Rick, who's like a drag racing engine, right? But then you've got the cathedral that has like a 4,000 horsepower engine.
Yeah.
Instead of like, you know, nitrous. Basically, the cathedral had nitrous oxide, whereas Rick doesn't. He's naturally aspirated.
You know Pat in episode 4, Tom.
Oh, he could give him a run for his money. Yeah. Yeah, basically.
But no, there are a few more questions here.
Uh-huh.
Which I will say, another one where you can answer, just watch a video.
Is this going to be about his history?
Well, kinda.
Because
would Rick have worked as a 484?
Well, no. Because he's a 482.
Yeah.
He is a mountain class. He has always been a mountain class.
But, well, not always. But...
And he has.
Tom. Well, no, because there's that original drawing you did.
Oh, are you on about... yeah, he was originally a 480.
Yeah.
And then I changed it to a 482 because it's more unique.
Yeah, but the thing I was going to say is there was a proposal for a design for Rick that was a 282?
Yeah, this is the... Oh, shit, hang on. I just realized where we are.
Break!
Wait, hang on. Let's use the power to our advantage. Look at that!
Also, someone said, did you consider making Rick a four-cylinder loco? He was.
Right, okay. Let's get back. Before we carry on, let's get back to the proposed design. There are two proposals for Rick's design. For DR1202. The first design... can basically, if you go back and watch the DR1202 history video, you'll get what I mean. You'll see a picture of it. But basically, there were two tenders given out for the design of the Dark Railways proposed for 482. Now, Better Peacock, the ones that won, they built the 482 that Lord Dark wanted, Lord Theodore Dark. However, North British turned around and said, building a 482 locomotive for your railway is a dumb idea. Here is a 282. And Lord Dark went, no. So the proposed North British design never came to fruition, which would have been a 282 capable of pulling something like 700 tons. Whereas Bear Peacock, wanting to impress, they said, yes, we'll build you an engine that can pull 1,000 tons up a 1 in 36. And then we were like, what? And then there's going to be people in the comment section going, why didn't the DR just buy one of the LMS Garretts? One, their axle boxing were rubbish. And secondly, they had a bad reputation anyway, so they wanted a new loco. Why didn't we buy the U1 Garrett off the LNER? One, they wouldn't sell it to us. And secondly, that was a little bit too big. Just a little bit. What was the other thing Gwyl said?
Gwyl?
Yeah, Gwyl was about to say something. Well, oh, there was another question.
I'm going to send you a message.
You're going to send me a message? Oh, God.
Can read it later.
Is this another message for Dark DJ? Are you calling me out again?
Yeah.
what I was going to say, that's it. Someone said about him being four-cylinder. Yeah, the original design built by Bear Peacock was a four-cylinder compound. As in, two inside cylinders fed by high-pressure steam from the boiler, and then you had the two outside cylinders fed from the high-pressure cylinder. The exhaust steam from the high-pressure went to the low-pressure, and then low-pressure went out the chimney. When he was rebuilt in 1934, because the original was built in 1933, it was rebuilt as a three-cylinder simple. Like, you know, the steam from the boiler goes into all three cylinders and then out the chimney. Now, Rick, because the thing I haven't actually properly explored, we're about to move off, so I'm just going to come here so I don't have to listen to him fucking blowing off incessantly, Rick! It's because we're on the downhill section, so it doesn't use any steam.
Yeah.
when he was rebuilt originally, they had to modify the inside part of the loco where the two cylinders were to make it one cylinder. So that part of the original designed locomotive before it was scrapped was always the weakest part. However, when DR1202 replica was built, Rick, he was built purposely to have that third cylinder, so he got a much stronger internal steam passages and all that. So he's actually the ultimate version of that. Like, the original locomotive always had the floor with the inside cylinder overheating, whereas Rick, he's been built purposely as a three-cylinder loco, so he is the ultimate version of the design, if that makes sense. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Imagine if they built two of the R1202s. The first one would have been the test bed. The second one...
A bit like with Cock of the North and Earl Marischal of the P2s. Because and then finally, the production batch, which was Mons Meg, Lord President, Fane of Fife, Wolf of Badlock, they improved over the original design. That is what Rick is. He's an evolution of the design. Because he's also got the autojector and the roller bearings as well.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what an autojector is, go and look up Abomination, because he has one too. Which is where Mr. Smash got the idea. Basically, Mr. Smash stole the idea off Abomination when he did an overhaul on him.
That's abominable.
That is literally abominationable.
Also, someone said, will you ever do a Rickroll in honor of Rick? I've already done one. Go to my channel.
Yeah, right, you've already done one. I have rolled Rick several times on his adventures. So yes, I have Rickrolled several times. Rolled Rick even. Although, to be fair, I am definitely going to have to name an episode Rickroll just to, you know, hammer it home.
Sorry, I missed all that. My brother called me.
Good.
Well, you're not getting it back. Sorry, Gwil, you've lost that. You'll have to watch the episode. You'll have to rewatch it later. Oh no!
Just watch it now.
Bollocks. Put it on the butter. Bollocks.
Put it on the bollocks butter.
I tell you what, actually, right? Something else that doesn't really come up much is Rick's cab. Yeah. Like, I actually really like Rick's cab. I also like the fact that Chris put in a pull-down whistle valve.
Oh yeah, he did that, didn't he?
Yeah, because he couldn't find space on the back head to put the whistle valve, so he put it up there at the top. But I actually really like that. That's one design change I like that Chris did. Same as, actually, there was originally, the original idea was that Rick was going to have a circular firehole door, a bit like on an LNER loco.
But
I told him I wanted an open-close one like this, like a Great Western one, so that's what we got in the end. Also, we've got the magical... the magical baffle plate that can go through the fucking magic baffle plate. I love it.
Hey, can I just take the credit for this one real quick?
Go on. No.
So someone said, man, Chris is the GOAT at train simulator models. He spelled it my name. Thank you.
Yes, Chris Rasmussen is the best. No, Chris. Everyone was getting things wrong. Right, Chris Rasmussen is Chris, as in Christian.
Aye.
Right. And Chris Wilson in Kris, which is an odd spelling of Chris, but eh.
No, that's to be fair, that's the normal Norwegian one.
That is really fucking strange.
Yeah.
What, the K?
Yeah. Kris, that's the standard Norwegian one, and they spelt mine with CH.
Oh, Andy joined us. Andy, hello.
Hello. Yeah, I've only come in very briefly to say that I'm going to bed, so...
All right, then, mate.
Okay.
I was going to say hi and bye to your... oh, my...
Tell you how you're having fun with your work tomorrow early morning.
Well, I just read your message, haha.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a funny one.
It is a funny joke.
We do it.
Funny joke.
Well, even better, we just need to... Well, we'll talk about it later on, but...
Yeah.
Oh, you're going to kill me.
Maybe.
I'll send it to you as well, Andy, if you've got some context.
Okay.
Actually, Andy, while you're here quickly...
Mm-hmm.
What would win in a drag race, Cathedral or Rick?
Me.
Andy would win a drag race between a Cathedral and Rick, everyone. Let's make sure we note that down for future reference. So it's like, someone ever asked you to go, right, who would win in a drag race, Cathedral or Rick? Oh, you've answered it before, Andy.
Yeah. Well, they were built for two completely different purposes.
So exactly. Yeah. One was built for hill climbing and freight train. The other one was built to go fucking meow. I mean... Whoa!
The other one was built to be the ultimate British locomotive.
Yeah, oof.
Well, I hope all the Rick fans out there are going to boycott Andy and Chris for their comments.
Hooray!
Hooray!
One was built for hill climbing, the other one was actually good.
There's only one person's going to do it, and his name is Tom.
I am really sad now. I'm going to cry.
No, you're not. You're Tom.
Oh.
Yeah, no. No. That's... about the whole name thing, Tom. I find it strange how the American is spelled the Norwegian way.
And the Norwegian way is spelled the American way. English way. Yeah, it's weird. Ugh.
Also, someone asked what kind of valve gear you have on, Rick, and what you, if you ever consider Caprati.
Okay, so, right. Here's a rundown of what valve gear the DR-1202 project has had. Right. When it was built as a four-cylinder locomotive, it had Penniston valve gear, which everyone, funny joke, we called it Peniston valve gear, because it looked like a giant cock and balls on the side of the loco. There is actually a picture of that on the wiki, if you want to go see that, if you're that way inclined. Traditionally always had Wolfshard's valve gear. However, having Caprotti valve gear would have been hench as fuck, but I don't think it would have really worked for him, one, for maintenance, and secondly, for being more designated back in the day, like back in the 30s and 40s, as a freight engine. Or mixed traffic, even. Like, you know, Caprotti, really, I associate with express passenger. But then again, Standard 5's had it, so maybe. Would have been interesting to see. And that's something else I actually wanted to address to everybody, because somebody has said to me a few times, Tom, why does he connect... Why does his outside cylinder connect onto the third axle rather than the second, like on other classes of loco? Well, one, I always turn around and say, well, what about the Somerset and Dorset 7Fs? They drive onto the third axle with valve gear. And secondly, most other freight designs do drive onto the third set of wheels.
Yep.
Especially if they're three-cylinder. Because let me explain. Rick drives onto the outside cylinder and drive onto the third. But the inside cylinder drives onto either the first or the second. I can't remember which one I've quite canonically said. If I look at him from the side, I'll realise. Yeah, I think it drives onto his second axle. So he got divided drive, basically. And that gives him more even torque when starting up trains.
Yeah.
Essentially. Like, his third axle... Basically, his third axle is a normal axle, but either the first or second axle, whichever one has the inside cylinder connecting to it, has a cranked axle. And it basically just means more even power through the entire set of wheels, rather than all of it being driven onto one axle.
And that makes me moist.
Does it?
No, not really.
Oh.
Also, I will just point out, if Jordan is in this stream still...
Which he isn't.
Suck my he was here earlier, but suck my massive white man cock.
Oof.
I drove the advanced loco all over the fucking Woodhead line and didn't even run out of water.
Bruh. Well, I made it to Waterloo.
Waterloo.
Oh my god.
Skip if I wanted it.
That's no. Gonna murder.
Anyway, I'm going to bed because I'm done.
Bye.
Okay, bye.
Feck off.
Feck off, cup.
Feck off, you little box.
Okay, bye.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Yeah, feck off, cup.
Hang on. Isn't Duke of Gloucester the only Class 8? Power Class 8?
No. Duchesses were Power Class 8. So were,
weren't Kings 8?
Kings were Power Class 8 as well.
Yeah. Unless he means, like, you know, 8. Like standard 8.
Yeah, Duke of Gloucester was the only standard 8.
Mm-hmm. Also, someone asked, was Rick's whistle sounds like a boat? Well, you see, Sonny Jim.
Well, the funny thing about that is that he's got a steamboat whistle because of how big and fat he is.
Yeah.
I think his whistle suits him more than it does on the Cardian that it came from. Personally, as in, you know, an engine of such a size as Rick should have a correspondingly massive whistle to go with it. Don't you agree?
I mean, he's overcompensating for sure, but...
Definitely. He's got very, very small cylinder cocks. In fact, he's got small cylinder cocks and very small buffers.
Yeah.
Therefore, he's got to overcompensate somewhere else and go...
So, are trains multi-gender because they have both buffers and cocks?
Yes.
Hot.
By the way, for anybody wanting to know certain things, there you go. Carry Case Smoosh Limited, DAC Valve, No 1202, Galen Jackson, 1980!
Crash Bash?
Yeah, Crash Bash. Crash Bash, that's a game for the PlayStation.
Oh, actually, someone just said, were there any other Dark Railway designs locomotive other than Rick and Bob?
Not really, no. They were concept designs I made ages ago, like MF drawings. Like, for example, a locomotive that would have been built, like a steam engine built in the 80s or 90s that had valve gear controlled by computers. That would turn quite
on. Oh, that fucking thing.
Yeah, with like weird oscillating valve gear. And I think there was also a design for a tank engine that would have been like a 210-4 for banking, a Pup Boy Bank. That would have been hench.
Yeah, you got a point, dude.
Here we go. Let's do a drag race out of the station. Come on. How quickly can you get away?
All the power.
I think Rick is a train.
Is he?
No.
I didn't think he was, to be honest. I thought he was actually a boat, because listen.
Why, fuck me.
I think he might be a boat. AP Mark 1s are very nice. Just thought I'd point that out while we're going away from the station.
You know what is better?
What?
AP Mark 3s.
Problem is, I get all their power, but because the speed limit is 25, I can get him away quickly, but then just like, yep, yeah, now I've got a plod. Danger, path, bleh, signal path danger approved. Any more questions about Rick? Apart from, is he a train?
The only things I can see is really, oh, what if Rick was this? What if Rick was this? What if Rick was this? And it's just like, ugh.
What if Rick was just Rick? How about that? Yeah. Have we ever thought about that one?
Mm-hmm.
He just hench. I think the only thing I did say, though, is that technically speaking, Rick's design isn't what a mountain was meant to be. He's a mountain by wheel arrangement only, because mountain classings were built to have the firebox slung after the rear axle of the driving wheels, but before, like, the trailing truck was meant to hold the weight of the firebox and the cab, whereas on Rick, he's got a wide but high firebox, and the rear axle, like the trailing truck, in to hold the cab. So,
this is actually an interesting one. So, does Rick have four revelations? It says
revolutions.
Well, it says revelations per full rotation on the driving wheels, or does he do a Lord Nelson and have eight?
I think it's four.
Fair.
If you listen to him when he goes along, he goes like, chugga 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 chugga.
Yeah.
So I think it's he's not like Lord Nelson, where he sounds like a machine gun going off. Yeah, basically. Even though he looks very much like a Lord Nelson from certain angles, especially when he got his normal tender, when he got his usual DR tender, like the Morsel tender. But when he got this one, he looked more to me like something that Gresley would have dreamed up. Especially those absolutely fucking stonk superheater headers. Look at them.
Yeah.
Those are like the biggest superheater headers I've ever seen.
They are pretty chunk.
They are very chunk.
Yeah. Can I just point out as well? Someone's asked this. Mm. Oh my god, is that moving?
In what moving?
Look at the superheated thing. What the fuck?
The superheater headers.
Yeah. It's just me, or was that slightly moving?
It's just the loco slightly.
It's just the loco. Yeah, look. See?
Oh, it's the entire thing. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's just Rick sort of vibrating because he's waiting to go. Although okay. I can hear the... hang on, wait. Oh, yeah, I can just hear it now. My favourite sound on the whole engine is the air pump. Just the thump, thump.
Oh, also, I want to address something.
Mm-hmm.
Someone said, am I the only person who thinks in Season 10, Episode 1, Clyde was a bit out of character? No, he wasn't.
I don't think he was.
That's legit Clyde's character. You saw Clyde's character when he first got introduced, but maybe that wasn't his true self, and now that he's got a new young body, he's turned a bit more
I think the idea with that, if we're going to talk about Season 10, Episode 1, is that we've seen the dickish side of Clyde back when he got his powers as a shapeshifter. And yes, even though he did feel bad about it, I think he still has a bit of that streak about him. Because think about it, he was a diesel engine all his life. He's now a steam engine. That's going to fuck with his mind, isn't it? Come on.
Yeah.
That if your physical appearance, if your whole physical appearance changed, and you had this ability to change your physical appearance at will, and now you can't, and you're stuck in one shape for the rest of your life that's different to the shape you started out in, do you not think that might have an effect on your mental health somehow?
Yeah.
Also, props to the shape-shifting scene where Clyde actually took on the form of Rick for temporarily. That was funny. Yeah.
Let's see.
But yeah, I mean, like, the other thing is I kind of have written it that story in a way that is supposed to show Clyde and Trip in different lights, as in, like, you know, at first, Trip was seen as more of a, you know, maybe an arsehole slash enemy. Yet now, Trip has settled down. He's tried to apologise. He's had his apology accepted, and he has actually actively made attempts to change his ways. Unfortunately, he's being let down by his own design and mechanical condition. Clyde, on the other hand, was, you know, more sympathetic, and he tried to help the railway, but I think he's also got some selfish motives as well, like, you know, survival, which is why he'd gone for the Caledonian 101, as in the 191, because he thinks that can he can hide properly from it, and as we've seen, it kind of backfired on him, because you've also got to realise that his mental state has fluxed again, because not only has he been picking on Trip because he's weaker than him, but he's also now had the whole idea of him having this shape-shifting ability come into question, hasn't it? You know?
Yeah.
Because now he's thinking, oh, if he was going to be sold to the DR anyway, what was the point of having all that happen? All the stuff that happened might not have happened if he hadn't have gone through the transformation at the end of Season 9. For example, the tau cannon might not have been overheated and the railway might have been rebuilt quicker. The tau cannon could have come in more use for Fear and Otto to maybe do something about the Linda demon. Clyde could have been continued to be in the diesel roster and help the DR out a lot more in diesel form, rather than being yet another steam engine of the 460 variety, which we kind of now have an influx of. We've now got four of the buggers.
Yeah.
However, what happens later on in the season, as you know, Chris, and so do you, Guillaume, kind of makes up for it.
Yeah. Can I just point out one thing here? And I can answer this too, because I make the series as well.
Mm-hmm.
Someone asked, Tom, has anyone ever told you to stop swearing in your series?
Yes!
Oh my god, they get this.
Yes, they have, right? Let me point this out, right? In 2 weeks' time, I will be a 30-year-old man. If I want to fucking swear, I'll fucking swear. My stuff is not for children. Yes, I fucking will, Guillaume.
You fucking will.
I fucking will, mate.
You fucking will.
You absolute grade A ocean going cunt.
Yeah, fuck it.
Right,
no, this is what we're saying. Like, this is our way of articulating ourselves. This is our way, our humor, our.
The other thing is, right?
It's how we are.
The other thing is, as well, is that I think I mentioned it before. It's been mentioned before. The Dark Railway and the engines that work there, it can be seen as not only just being a family and friends, but it's also a workplace.
Yeah.
In workplaces, people swear all the time. I mean, look at, I don't like to go back to it, but look at the railway series. It's implied that Duncan from the narrow gauge railway, he swore a lot because he comes from an industrial railway. So, you know, it's not exactly uncommon. Besides, that's just how the English language works. I don't advertise my stuff for children, and I don't see the need to do it for children. I see TDRS as being an evolution of people who were my age who watched Thomas and Friends when they were younger. It's for a more mature audience.
Yeah.
Now, if I do go along with Great Western, that will probably also be for a more mature audience, but I probably Did I say Great Western?
You said Great Western.
Okay, I meant Northwestern. I do apologise. Yeah. If I go ahead with Northwestern, that will probably have adult themes, but it's not going to have swearing or, like, you know, sexual innuendos or anything. It's going to be more of a more mature, like, you know, whatever. A more mature undertaking of the source material. You know, but as regards to swearing in things, like, you know, people swear all the time. You lot can't tell me, like, nobody in the chat can tell me at all that they have never sworn in their entire life. That is almost an impossibility. And if you have done that, then you're a liar.
Yeah. No.
So I don't see a problem with it. Gwil, do you see a problem with swearing in my series?
I fucking do, mate.
Right.
You shouldn't be fucking swearing, you fucking knobhead little tit wank shit.
Right, well, Gwion's on the mood.
Right, so Gwion's now fired.
I mean, I don't understand the cunt in hell why everyone has to fucking swear.
I don't fucking understand why people have to fuck it. Anyway,
I don't fucking swear.
The thing is, as well, you can say, it's a way of articulating yourself, particularly anger, you know, excitement, stuff like that. But you can also write scenes where you don't swear.
Yeah, and it can come across completely differently.
No, not just that, but it can also come across as the same. Like, you can get the motive across without swearing. We don't use, like, look at my, okay, I'm going to advertise here a bit. My scene in episode 5,
sorry.
where Buck has a rant at Hart Hall, who we hate now, by the way.
Oh, yeah, I completely endorse hating Hart Hall. I don't give a shit if people hate me for it. I hate Hart Hall as well, so he's a guy you love to hate a lot. Die. Kill him. Anyway, carry on, Chris, sorry.
No, but the thing is, Buck goes on a full fucking rampage towards Hart Hall, and I think he swears like once. And it still gets the point across, you know?
Yeah.
You don't need swearing to get the point across, but I just feel it's more funny when it's just like, for example, oh, we're gay lovers, sir. Ramsay, what the fuck, mate? Like, you know, it's the fuck?
It's like a sudden reaction, isn't it?
Yeah,
you know, it's like you're not gonna keep your composure every time, even as a manager. I mean, I look at Mr. Dark last season. Yeah, it was last season where he goes, son, what the fuck did you do to my railway? See, that is a reactionary shot. You can do reactionary, but you can also at the same time you can write scenes where swearing is not necessary. That is just the way I write things. Like, I mean, I'm never going to turn around and say, like, advocate people for not swearing. Like, as in, like, what I mean by that is, I'm not going to have a go at anybody who swears, because I do it all the time, every day. It's just a natural thing for me. So, I'm not going to deny that fact, and I'm not going to deny anybody who does swear. What I do not like is when people insist that you don't swear. It's like, dude, we, in any language...
Dude, fuck off.
Well, yeah, basically, fuck off. Fuck off! Monkey on the car!
This is the thing I say, though, Tom. It's like, to be fair, if you boil it down, it's just words branded.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, I'm not going to say
it's
the word,
words
but there are words in the English language, including some very naughty bad words, that the only reason that they are considered bad is because we have made them bad.
We have
basically dictated, like, you could say giggity-boggity, and that could be considered somewhere as a swear word. It's just like, you know, it's just the way that things roll. Like, language is language. So that's really all I've got to say on the matter, apart from the fact that Goyon has a big head.
Yeah. Let me just quote everyone's favorite Norwegian word, faen.
Faen?
Which is an older Scandinavian word, fjandin, which means the devil. That's all it is. But it's been branded as the worst Norwegian swear word, I think.
Is it?
Anyways, this has been our TED Talk on swearing.
Yeah, this has been our TED Talk on swearing on a stream that's meant to be about my very innocent character who doesn't swear.
And after that really great long fucking tangent...
Honestly, like, I see him being the most innocent engine on the DR. Even more than Abomination, because Abomination is fucking lazy, isn't he?
Daddy Rico.
Daddy Rico, fuck's sake. Well, no, like, Abomination is, like, really a really powerful tank engine. Like, he's a 5F. And he's the laziest engine going on the railway. He literally doesn't like doing any work. And then you're going to have Rick, who is like, he's really keen to work. He's really keen to do all this, but he also doesn't want the limelight. He kind of just wants to get on with it and actually prove himself to be an engine, basically. He wants to prove himself to actually be, you know, worthy of being built, if that makes sense. As in, like, he feels like he shouldn't have been built because of the way the other engines have reacted to him. And that's where I think Dave and Hannah come into it. And, you know, Dave takes him under his wing and basically doesn't teach him the bad things in life, but he actually just kind of looks after him.
Here, Rick, have some Heineken.
Yeah.
I just imagine.
Yeah, I actually, get, here's how it goes. Just like Rick backs into the sheds looking mournful, and David just sat there. Hey, up, Rick, what's up? Oh, I've had a really bad day, Dave. Everybody's been picking on me. Have a beer. What? Have a beer. You'll feel better. But I'm only a couple of months old. Hey, who cares? Have a beer.
Alan had one when he was 2 months old. Fucking drink.
Alan's been drinking since he was 2 months old. Get over it, Rick. Have a drink. Well, that's the other thing as well. For people who don't, who aren't going to like the way that I introduced Rick and being basically preloaded with language and, you know, the physical ability and whatnot and the, like, cognitive ability of a teenager, all you got to do is, well, no, all you got to do is look back to season 2 when Alan was introduced. He already has his whole personality and he's 2 months old. And we explain it as being basically like an unknown of the universe. It's like we don't know everything about how the universe works. And this is also, as we've said before, a separate universe where the steam engines have thoughts and feelings. There doesn't have to be a physical, you know, physical reason for it.
Yeah, I agree.
But
that's what I'm going to do with Redwood Cathedral as well.
Yeah.
When he is introduced.
Well, yeah, because like I say, at the end of the day, you can't really. I don't like the idea of having a character and basically a baby. That's why Abomination was never introduced as a baby, despite being 4 months old. Neither was Owen, actually, because Owen was only built in 1960 when he first appeared in DDRS. So I just don't like that idea.
Nah. But that's the thing I'm going to say as well. Like, Redwood Cathedral, he's going to need to learn how to, you know.
Oh, what the hell happened?
Handle a train. He's going to learn how to do everything under the sun, but he's still going to know how to talk. He's still going to have a name, you know.
Hmm. Oh, God, we're looking forward to these things coming out, aren't we, Chris?
Huh?
I said we're looking forward to these things coming out, aren't we, the cathedrals?
Oh, don't even.
Basically, like, I mean, it's kind of weird, really, because it's actually technically through me that we've actually got here in the first place, because if I hadn't recommended Chris for his work on DR-1202, we might not have ever gotten the courage up to do this, would we?
Bitch, there's other locomotives, though. But no.
I meant the whole commissioning thing.
Oh, no. How do I say this? Let me explain this in the best way I possibly can. We probably still would have through the fact that Bruce has also commissioned a few of his things through him.
Yeah, but more the fact it's a fictional loco.
That's exactly it. That's nail on the head. You commissioned a fictional loco and he did Rick this much justice. That's why we had full belief in the cathedral. Like, Chris is amazing model, don't get me wrong, but if we hadn't seen any work on a fictitious loco before, we might have been a bit more apprehensive.
Yeah.
But
then again, I think Chris, not being funny, and this is not me slighting Rick, because Rick is completely fictional, whereas the Hawksworth Cathedral at least has some basis in reality, if that makes sense.
Yes, I completely agree with that. Rick is fully fictional. The cathedral, and I will point this out as well, because I know some motherfuckers out there.
Oh my god.
Oh, never press safety valve button. Oh, he wouldn't have done that.
No. Me and Chris can both vouch for this, and so can Andy. The original design drawings did not have a safety valve because this was Hawksworth trying to get forward. I mean, of course, we have taken other liberties, for example, with the front bogey being, like, you know, similar to a King's one, but, I mean, you know, who cares?
It's a westernized Prince's Royal. Let's not lie. That's what it looks like. Come on. Let's be fair here.
Still going to be hench. I mean, looking at that alongside the Princess Royal will be absolutely hench as fuck.
Yeah.
Oh, excuse me. And also, technically speaking, if I put Rick next to them, you've kind of got these three big, massive, chunky engines, right? But the other thing is they all don't have smoke deflectors either, which is something I really like. Because Princess Royal... Yeah, Kathleen don't have them. Princess Royal's never had them. And I swear to God, if someone ever puts proper smoke deflectors on Rick, they will get murdered to death.
Like, hi, Tom.
Looks at the time when he's going to visit, like, Redwick someday. And it's like... you're like... You literally just Photoshop some fucking...
Tom.
What?
I'm going to do it.
That'd be kind of interesting, though. Because that means I would basically have to have your route and then film it. You the scene.
Well, you're gonna have my route anyways.
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah, but that means that means I've got to essentially film you an entire epic, Chris. I realise what you've done here. You bitch. You've made it so I have to film an episode for you, you bitch. That's it.
He finally figured it out.
Bitch.
You know what else, though?
What?
Andy's going to have to film for me as well.
Why's Andy got to film for you? Hunters?
Redwick Cathedral being built?
Oh, yeah, because it's going to be built at Alfredston. Yeah, because the story behind ours is that all of these other ones are built in like 50s, 60s, whenever. All these other cathedrals that are in our fictional circles of loco built after F.W. Hawkworth, God bless his soul. Well, thank God he's still around, actually, because we've decided. But the funny thing is, my cathedral isn't built. Is built out of basically a kit of parts that were built but never erected, and it's not built until 1993 at Carcass Smash Limited. So it's a new build engine, but it's built out of patterns and parts that were built back in like the 50s. Because they basically, the idea is that they were all spare parts, and then they because they didn't need the spare parts because there are so many plentiful cathedrals out there anyway. They sold all these parts that were built but never erected to the DR for us to build our own. And then it's just competition for Rick, basically. You know, and then everyone basically turned around and saying, why did you want a cathedral? Well, because we had F.W. Hawkworth visit, and we've had the other cathedral visit, and we wanted our own. But no one would let us buy one.
I'm sorry, my internet just committed 257 of a Mirkum.
Oh, my fucking God.
Sorry about that. I'm back.
I'm black.
Hide the set! No, anyways.
Oh.
No, so the thing is just, I cannot wait to show the people in the chat and, well, the ones who are interested in my fucking work, because I know not everyone is, because I'm a retard.
Who the fuck are you?
Chris. Anyways.
Shit. Kyle.
I can't wait to show you guys what I have planned for River Cathedral, because it's not just going to be, oh look, we have a cathedral. This thing works perfectly and outshines everything. Wait and see. I have plans.
Oh yeah, so I know the plans as well, and I think it's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Not as good as one being exploded in, you know, exploding along a siding, like a certain Truro Cathedral does.
Yeah. Oh, dude, I'm stuffed.
What, like a stuffed crust pizza?
Someone just asked, thoughts on Thomas and Friends Season 25, guys? I have no strong opinions because I'm afraid Mattel will take down this video.
I am also afraid that Mattel will take down the videos, therefore I have no strong opinions on Thomas and Friends Season 25. It's gonna be shit! Anyway.
Yeah, I agree. It's so bad.
To be fair, do you guys want to know a story? This is kind of why, I mean, Chris knows about this, I think Will does as well, but I basically, the whole idea for me doing this whole thing, which I've called, for the time being, Northwestern, which is essentially a railway series, homage slash reboot, whatever, in my style, like, you know, in the style of TDRS. Basically, the whole, that idea has been floating around for a good long while, hasn't it, Chris? But,
yeah.
I told you, when I saw the thing for season 25 of Thomas and Friends, that was just my last draw. That was a bit like, I want to do the Reverend Audrey justice, so I want to do something that he might enjoy. You know, if it had been put in the right hands. Because there's a lot of good fan content out there, like, you know, in the Train Z community and all that lot. And people who do the animations and write the fictions and all that. Most people are very good at it. But I kind of want to do my own personal take on it, I think. And now that I've got an established fan base, I know people know what my work is like. I'd kind of like to do that. I know I mentioned this in a previous stream, but I would kind of like to just do something, like make every character slightly different in some way and but follow the similar stories. For example, I wouldn't have Thomas be a E2. He would be a J50, because that is what the original broomstick handle built model that the Reverend Audrey built for Christopher Audrey was. Like, had the look of, because it had the slanting tanks. And I kind of think that would be a better fit for being in the northwest of England as well. Same as Henry. Original, I mean, it would mean writing out a lot of Henry's character traits and his rebuild and whatnot. But my idea was he would be a an Ivat Atlantic, because that is what the Reverend Audrey originally wanted Henry to be, an Atlantic, which is said a lot in the Island of Sodor books. Gordon wouldn't, his story would change as well, because instead of being an A0, he would be a Raven A2. Like the prototype Raven A2 2400. And the reason that he has sold to Northwestern is because when the LNER is formed, he's not needed anymore. Which makes more sense, because he's a very big and cumbersome loco. But that also makes more credence for the fact that Gordon is the biggest engine on the island. Like, quite literally, he is too big. And, like, the idea is that he gets very puffed up in the smoke box when he goes over to Northwestern, because he goes over to Barrow and Furnace, meets a load of LMS engines there, and they're all enamoured with his size, because the LMS at this point didn't have anything that size. So that makes Gordon feel very big and important, because he's little engines. And then you've got Edward, who would be a Denalister, an ex-Caledonian loco. He'd see through it and say, you know, age is nothing to do with experience. But I'm getting off topic a little bit. The idea, basically, though, is that if I were to do it, and I would do it in my own style and do it in a similar vein to TDRS, but also take, like, inspiration from it.
It's basically Parallel Universe Thomas.
You could call it that, yeah.
But, yeah, so, like, the general gist is still there, but it's, like, there are known obvious differences.
Yeah.
It's like reboots of TV shows or films as well. They're 90% there.
I kind of call it a reimagining. Or if you really want to be specific, you could call this the 77C version of the Island of Sodor and the Northwestern Railway. If that makes sense. Does that make sense? Because my history is already different, isn't it? So if we've got an island in the middle of the Bristol Channel and Kent that is like ballooned to twice the size it actually is in our universe, then what I want to say that the Island of Sodor doesn't actually exist, but it's more realistic and, you know, has engines that are more appropriate for the region, if you know what I mean. That's how I see it, anyway. I would see it as my 77C universe version of the Reverend Audrey's work, and I'd like to think it would be something that... I don't know whether he nor Christopher would, like, have liked it, but I don't even know whether the fans of Thomas and Friends or the Railway series would like it, but it's something I kind of just wanted to do. And it's kind of bring it back to Rick a little bit, which is, again, like, showing what fiction can do. You know, because, I mean, look, we've got right here, right in front of us now, a fictional standard gauge 482 mountain class locomotive that actually fits within the loading gauge and looks like it could have been a real prototype locomotive, right?
Yeah.
And that's what fiction can do for you. Like, you know, this came from a crappy MS Paint drawing I made, which was made better by Anthony and then realigned by Chris Wilson as a physical model. Not many people can really turn around and say that, can they? Apart from those in the Trains Ed community who have more skill than I have. But I think it's more the fact that I think Rick, to me, in my mind, he is real. Which is weird to say. Because in my mind, he is real.
Yeah.
But that's probably because I'm really sad and I just love him a lot.
Well then, you know, if he's real,
God,
he's
Rick,
real.
Give him a big belly rub.
Mate, I'd love to give him a big cuddle. I think if I, it's a bit dark, but I think if we could pass over and have whatever we wanted in the afterlife, I would love it if I could literally have my characters be, like, real things and be alive and be able to actually speak to them. Especially, like, having an engine like Rick around would be lovely. Especially the way I envision him being, you know, innocent and kind and caring and wanting to do good. And being able to beat the absolute living shit out of everybody if they come near him. A bit like, that reminds me a little bit of Howard in Burning, when he tries to pick on Abomination, and Abomination being smaller than him, he can still pin a fucking Deltic to the buffers. That's amazing. And Rick could do that with probably about 5 Deltics.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. Did either of you two catch if anyone liked the idea of coming up with?
Yeah, people really like it. From what I can see, anyways.
Yeah.
So don't worry about that. You have a good idea in front of you. You just gotta execute it.
Well, to be honest, I've got to work on the other thing later this year, haven't I? Well, very slowly. That's not going to be a big... I'm not sure yet. I'm going to look, because I've got an idea that both that and Season 1 of Northwestern are only going to be between 6 and 8 episodes long.
Yeah.
And I've still got a load of Ed and Sid to release. Oh, my God, Ed and Sid. We've got Wide Ed and Sid coming up. We've got freaking house parties. We've got dates. We've got narrators fucking about with them. Oh, my God, it's going to be good. Rick, I can't help but notice your boiler pressure's not going up, mate. Which is better, because at least he wasn't peeing. He hasn't been pissing...
pissing steam or...
yeah. But he will need it for on the way back, probably. Actually, do you know what? I'm not going to fill up the firebox yet.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'll do it when we're at Minehead on the way back to Blue Anchor. Because I'm going to have to reset all the paths on the way back. Because what I'm probably going to do is get to Minehead now. I'm probably going to go put him on the turntable and get him turned. And then I'm going to go for a cigarette. And then I'm going to drive back, probably non-stop on the way back. So that I can, you know... Or maybe even just see if I can do a speed test or something and derail him. Because I know people like watching trains derail. Then again, I'm not really sure when it's derail, Rick. I'm definitely going to do a speed test here now, though.
Going to do a speed test, are you?
Well, yeah, because we're on a straight track between Dunster and Minehead. So I'm going to see how quickly you can accelerate and get up to speed proper.
Nice.
And not bother stopping at, what do you call it, Dunster?
That's pretty dumb, sir.
Brilliant. I've been to Dunster, actually. It's nicer. Been to the castle. The castle's lovely.
You've been to West Somerset?
Yeah, but what I mean is I've actually, like, when I stayed up here, I went up to Dunster Castle. And I got spooked out, actually, because, you know, I'm like... I don't know whether many people actually know, but you know, like, I'm always putting supernatural stuff into TDRS?
No,
Well, that's because I'm in what... I think they call it an empath?
Yeah.
As in, I can see auras, I can see, like, spirits and things, like, or at least what I perceive to be spirits. And I get that, like, weird, nauseating feeling as well. Like, the big best example, when I went to Giva Tin Mine in Cornwall, we're coming through Dunster now. I did do that speed test after all, I think it's because I'm concentrating on talking. We went into the washery, as in, like, where the men would have, like, changed and all that. And I know that most of them were still alive, but... I was just overwhelmed by sadness, like an actual, like, literally, like, grief, proper grief and sadness. Like, Tracy had to take me out of there because I just felt so upset and I felt all this grief about all these people who have lost their jobs and other people who have lost their incomes and all that. I don't know what happened, but it was almost like the place basically, you know, it just welled up inside of me.
Yeah.
It was really quite distressing, and I've had things like that happen before, and it's really not a fun thing to have, but... My auntie keeps saying that it's because I'm in touch with my spiritual side. I don't want to be in touch with the bloody spiritual side. I'm fucking terrified of that sort of stuff happening. I mean, it's like when I was at one of my last jobs, you know, like we've had the thing what's happened at my work with the cereal being thrown off the shelves, and we've had the guy who was still at the end of the corridor, and then I looked back and he was gone. And this is a corridor full of junk, I might add. And then there was the guy who walked into... I was doing some filing in my office when I was working at the college in Bournemouth. And I turned around and there's a bloke stood there and he sort of like had, I wouldn't say a sailor suit, but it was like quite a smart suit, sort of like, you know, old timey thing. And I sort of looked back to put my file back on the shelf and I said, I'll be with you in a second, like as in to turn around to go back to my computer. I turned around and gone. And there's no way he could have gone out of the door that's at the end of the aisleway because you'd hear it open because it's one of those big heavy doors. And there's nowhere else the guy could have gone. So it like really... freaked me out a lot, the office, and went back and sat behind my computer and just cowered there for a bit. And when my colleagues came back, like, why are you sat here on your own? I was like, you wouldn't believe me if I told you.
Yeah, I get you.
Yeah, but it's not very nice. But that's kind of also a semi reason why I put a lot of supernatural stuff into TDRS.
Yeah. Dude, trust me, I get you. I had the same thing when I was just, you know, still in school, looking at, like, being with real electricians. We were in the back room, right?
Yeah.
This old lady walks past us into the, like, the storage room in the back.
Yeah.
2 seconds later, we go after.
And she's gone.
And she's not in there, and there's no other door.
Yeah, that's
me and the guy. Me and the guy just looked at each other, and we were like...
Fun?
Yeah, literally. People ask if you'll ever have an permanent LNER local. You have Rick.
He's not LNER.
He is.
No.
Hmm? You cannot change my mind. Rick is LNER.
No, he's not. Rick LNER. Hey, I'm not sure. I mean, the only real contender I've had is if we need another big tank engine would be getting A5. because I like the idea of an A5 being preserved on the DR, purely because it's like one of my favourite Great Central type locos. It's also a good companion for Brian, you know, being the opposite wheel arrangement to Brian. And then there is, I don't know, mate, I was thinking about a, funnily enough, a 3000 class. And you see where I'm going with this one. It's a Great Central designed loco, built by the Railway Operating Division, and then sold to the Great Western Railway.
Yeah.
So that is a mindfuck. That is basically...
Oh boy.
Right, let's check the back of the train. Yeah, we can stop wherever now.
Okay.
Right, now this has to work because if I can't turn him on the turntable, he is not going to work on the way back.
Now, is this the modified one?
Yes.
He's got the short tender as well, so...
He should fit. I did check it earlier on. He does. I think he will fit. I've just got to wait for the marker to say that we've stopped here. Because then it'll say no current detonation. No current detonation. Which means now we've got control of the point work again, I hope. Let me just check that. Is that point changing? I think, hang on, let me try this one. Yeah, that one's changing.
I'd drive it forward and see if you can change it.
Yeah. I can just go to, up here. Oh, it's connected for him to go through. Can you imagine being at Minehead and seeing this gigantic green monster just... I mean, look at the fucking size of him compared to this woman. Jesus Christ. I mean, you know what they say about girth, I suppose. Anyone? No? Okay.
Big I'm sorry, I zoned out.
Big shoes. Big socks.
Oh, I'm going to sneeze.
You know what they say about big engines.
Apologies. Well, to be fair, Tom, you have a bunch of LNER locals to choose from.
Really?
Well, as soon as Chris makes them.
Right, good. I can change the points. Excellent.
Wee. What's the point of that?
Now, let's get Rick over to the turntable so that I can go for a cigarette. Unfortunately, that does mean I'm going to have to ask you two to do some unspeakable thing, which is... Well, actually, I'm going to say... Yeah, go on, get it. Entertainment, I'm afraid. I'm sorry, guys. I'm going to have to leave you in the capable or incapable hands, whichever way you want to think about it, of Gwion and Chris.
See, what you should have done is allowed me to have control of your computer, and then I could have just driven your logo around.
How about this?
No.
Give me control, because I'm a better driver than Gwion.
That's absolute bullshit, and
That is absolutely and categorically true.
I drive more often than you do.
But I've driven Rick.
Chris has driven Rick.
So am I.
Not as much as me.
Well, if we want to play that game, Guillaume, I think the person who has driven Rick the most is currently sat right here driving him right now.
Yeah, but you're not available.
I know I'm not available. I am taken, unfortunately. But...
Mean.
You know what I mean.
Little rip.
Anyway, no, it's fine. We'll just have Rick paused at the front of the train because obviously the train has to wait here for a while anyway. So, in fact, we need to build a boiler pressure back up anyway. And I'm just going to lower it a bit by filling the boiler up. I'm doing this on purpose, by the way, so it doesn't blow off.
Blowy.
Well, you can blow me. I mean,
I like operating from this camera view.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, while Tom is gone... Wait, shit, he's still here. Fuck.
I'm going to say, please don't just plug your own stuff. We're already doing enough of that with Chris and Gwion in Ed and Sid.
I was literally going to go on about your Patreon and Teespring.
Oh, you can plug that. Graham's starting to like Ed and Sid again, aren't you, Graham?
I've always liked Ed and Sid.
Well, I think we've... I mean, what did the audience think of Ed and Sid, actually? Because me and my dad have basically turned up with the hypothesis that Ed and Sid is a perfect thing nowadays because they're short, funny videos that anybody could just pick up and watch whenever. And they don't have to make sense. They're just fun, entertainment.
Binge watch them.
Yeah.
Binge watch them every 5 minutes.
Oh, don't do this to me, you bastard! It's not going to let me change the bloody points, is it? Really, I get all the way up here, and you're not going to let me change the points into the yard? Let me see if I can force change them as I get close to them. But more importantly, yeah, it's let me change them points, so why won't it let me change these? Change.
That's really fucking annoying.
Well, yeah, because that's going to mean I'm going to have to load up a whole new scenario to go back the other way.
10 to first.
I can't go 10 to first.
Modified.
Yeah, I can't go 10 to first.
How about Thunder third?
I've got an idea. Because I still want to actually physically turn him. So what we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, is be a bit sneaky cheeky. Right, let's set the time to, what is it, probably about an hour we've been going.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, what?
You going the wrong way?
What?
You going the wrong way?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you are.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you are.
I think I hear my other half coming home. Right, come on, where is the line and the sea? Oh, we're getting scenery again. Must be getting close. This looks like it could be Washford, I think.
Okay, can I just point one thing out here?
No.
So someone just wrote Chris, how are you, in Swedish in your chat.
Right.
But he typed it as KR instead of CHR.
Oh my God.
We literally had this conversation earlier.
Jesus Christ. I think I can...
It's the non-important one.
I can definitely hear him out there. Right. If I put the train there, turn it round. That's not really where it was, but hang on. If I move up slightly... hang on. I want to put the train basically where it was there. Right, okay, and we've got the version of Rick still, yep. So what we're going to do is, we are going to, I'm going to put him here, and I'm going to see whether the point, it'll let me change the point because it's a free roam. In fact, let me just go up there in the map editor view and see if I can actually physically change those points. Yes, I can. I think because I set destinations. And once you've set that destination, I don't think it likes you changing the points again afterwards in some places.
The only way you would have fixed it is by putting a waypoint on the turntable.
That doesn't work either.
Fuck's sakes.
Yeah.
A waypoint in front of the turntable?
Maybe. Right, so that's going to let me go over to the turntable anyway. So, right, we're going to pretend nothing happened, everyone, ladies and gents. Unfortunately, Rick does now have full boiler pressure again. So let's turn off his blower.
Is blowy.
I'm sure I can hear my other half outside, like outside the front, the back, the door. So I'm just going to go to the turntable now.
Well.
And then I'm going to see if she's out there. Because it might be that she's not got a key or something.
Tom.
Mm-hmm.
To be fair, with how much we've been talking about paranormal stuff tonight.
Yeah, that's not happening, Chris, don't worry.
Damn.
So, remember, everybody, nothing happened there. We didn't have to edit the scenario or anything, did we, Chris?
No, we did nothing at all. I'll talk to you guys when Tom isn't here again.
Just ask this scientist. He'll tell you that everything's fine. He'll tell you everything is absolutely amazing and fine.
Well, hang on, Tom, did you set it up with, like, icons and, like, destination markers?
I did, yeah, but it meant...
You're a fucking idiot.
No, it was meant to reset once you get to the end, because I only put one marker in to stop at.
Yeah.
And it changed the other points, and just the game being done. You watch, I'll go and do this whole turning around thing, and then it won't let me back onto the coaches or some shit. Now, next question is... I've got to do something quick, I think. Yeah. Run away! And then back! There we go. It's right, the turntable didn't fall in. Right, now this should work. I just want to prove to everybody that he does indeed fit on a turntable and can be turned. Right, so there you go. His rear end is on. His buffers are slightly overhanging, but potentially, if I press 8 and go here. This is the deck to view anyway. Right, here we go, everyone. Can Rick be turned on a turntable? Yes, he can. Intendo decided to go blobby, but he can actually be turned on the turntable.
Can he fuck?
Yes. I'm not quite sure what's going on with the turntable, but... And the other thing we've noticed as well, unlike on Bottom of Games logos, the wheels don't start flapping around. Notice that wheel? That Rick's wheel didn't flap around while he was being turned.
Didn't flap around?
Yeah, they didn't flap around like on Bossman locos.
Yes, because Bossman locos use... because the advanced script, the rotation of the wheels are based on the speed of the locomotive, but it doesn't mean speed along the track, it means speed from its relative position in space.
Which is really
so
weird.
So you're using... If you use a traverser or a turntable, it has speed. If you actually... have the HUD up when you're on the turntable, you'll actually see that
it goes like at 0.1, 0.2 miles an hour and stuff like that.
Unfortunately, when we do get to 2.0, that will also be happening to our locos, unless I think of some completely big brain move to fix it.
Which is going to be difficult considering you're Guion.
Well, first of all, Guion, you have to see if I can get some Bully Light Pacific sounds on Rick so that your chimney sounds better. Like we tried earlier on and couldn't get to work.
Oh shit, I may have just had a big brain move and I might have actually figured it out.
Did I help? Well, it happened on my stream, so I helped. I helped, everyone! I helped! Let it be known that Duck DJ Productions...
I'll have to do some tests.
Let it be known that Duck DJ Productions helped SimNation.
First time for everything.
Wow. You have no faith in me, Chris.
No, I don't.
Oh.
But I love you.
Puff. Anyway. Can we reconnect to our train now? Yes. Right, there we go. We did it, guys.
Jit.
I'm assuming the comment section cooled down a bit for the time being, is it?
Oh, no, it's still going. It's just they're having chats.
Oh. You know, I swear sometimes that they're... when Clark and Mr. B meet? Oh my god, yeah.
They're like, do they have a relationship like 257 and Eustace? No. I don't think they met before. Because Clark is basically what I've decided.
We've decided he's more like an industrial version of the O4.
Yeah, he's like a prototype industrial thing.
He's a bit like the prototype diesel shunters that you saw back in the day anyway.
Yeah.
It just so happened to look like an O4. Because he was built by Drury Car Company ahead of the production batch.
Yep. That's why he doesn't have a number.
True.
He's just called Clark.
And that's probably because they made a mistake when they were doing some things. They were like, oh, right, so how's that clerk doing out there trying to put all this paperwork together? And they just said, they mistook that and named the locomotive Clark.
Yeah, for some fucking reason.
For some dumb reason. Anyway, now we're at the front of the train. We're going to let the boiler pressure piss itself away while I go for a cigarette. So, I'll only be a couple of minutes. So,
goodbye.
Goodbye. If you two want to entertain the audience for a moment, that'd be great.
Shouldn't be too hard.
5 minutes later. So, guys, I ain't got a BRB screen anymore. Oh, well, you guys don't BRB. BRB.
And Thomas now crashed his engine. Don't mind me, though, guys. I've just been watching fucking Avengers movie clips while I've fucking been watching this.
Kedge. There's big fat boy Rick pissing away his boiler pressure.
Okay, let's see. I will also say to the people that Tom is actually serious about maybe doing this Northwestern thing, and we are going to help him. It's going to be better.
We?
Okay, Gwion ain't, because Gwion's a cunt. But the other people who are actually Tom's friends and like the guy and don't just use him for his views so he could advertise his own products.
Bollocks, you know that, right? I'm sorry, but you lot are not my target audience.
Thanks, asshole. Anyways, no. Yeah, we're going to help him. But I think he's basically got it all figured out. What else did I talk about? Did you guys know that Rick has two different nameplates? Currently, he's wearing his L and ER ones, but he also has some DR ones that he uses when he's at home.
Wow. Check out Mr. Trivia over here.
Mm-hmm. Hey, I helped write some trivia with Rick.
It's pretty trivial.
Ladies and gentlemen,
there's better puns than fucking James Oliver and any of them lot.
Yeah, how about this? Did you guys know that Rick has a small nose?
He has a small nose. I didn't think he had a nose at all.
Exactly. Is that small?
Bloody hell. That's really small. I must admit, like,
sort of like your dick. Anyway.
Whoa, no. You ain't seen nothing, boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, should we tell Gwion about the webcams?
About the webcams, about the webcams. You don't need webcams to see my peenie. Eat my penis! Chris, on the other hand, he requires an electronic microscope. Yes, visible light is not capable of viewing it.
Someone has a question. And sorry, I'm sorry, Tom, for hijacking your stream slightly because the question got asked of me. is Buck personality deeper like we saw in episode 5? Yes. And you're also, technically, TDR is related. You're also going to see that in the Dark Railway series. Spoilers.
Grunge.
Also, someone said VA, and I don't know what the fuck they mean. Voice actor? Hi. Yes.
Vaginal alert?
Maybe. Vaginal operation. Oh, look at the tits on that lady. I mean, anyways.
Pussy.
I like big pussy. Okay.
Spoiler alert, Batman dies in Endgame. Sure.
Yeah, sure. Let's see, what is my phone saying? My phone is saying that I have been spam messaged.
Well, that's all I've had today from work, is just millions and millions of notifications from Fulton Edfetter's Instagram. Mm-hmm. Dark DJ Productions, hi, how are you today? He's not here. This is the takeover show by Gwion Rhys-Davies and Christian Retribution.
Lol. King Warrior said, well, we did see Buck and Gal and Junction Museum tour. Yes, you did. And that's only because we kicked him off our railway because we were sick of his shit. But yes, Buck's personality, look at the kind of like mine. On the surface, I'm happy-go-lucky. You're going to learn a few things about Buck as the series progresses.
That he's a grade A wanker and literally needs to like move to Derail Valley.
Yeah. We're also going to have a character based on Gwion. It's just going to be the sun. Because that's the size of his fucking ego. and his tummy.
I can hear you, you know. He fan hear us?
He can hear us. I think he can hear us. Wait a minute, he can hear us. I know you can hear me, Tom.
But he can't do anything. He's over there and we're over here.
There was a question asked. You told me to interact with the viewers. And if the question's been asked, if the gauntlet's been put down, I gotta pick it up, you know?
Cack, no. Yeah, I think you've, no. Dave's ego is nothing in comparison to mine.
Gwen's Guigo.
My Guigo.
You can Guigo fuck yourself.
Anyway.
I just base it on my limitless potential.
I have returned. You know what
you
that
have
means?
Have returned. That means that we can stop the shit posting and we can get onto the show.
Yes. Which is going to be us doing almost a freeze run back to the other end of the line. If I get the point to work properly.
Hmm. Oh shit, Tom's back!
I mean, yeah, we established that.
Wow, that was a really delayed response there.
That was a joke.
Right. It's a really shit joke.
No, I've never been to Norris Railway in Sweden. The first I've been into Sweden is like the place where I can shop for food and then get the fuck out again before I start losing brain cells.
You had brain cells in the first place.
Yeah. I've been to Sweden. I went to a little town up north called Kalix, and then I was there for a few days, and then I went for a couple of days to Stockholm. And I did a brief little stint jumping over the border into Finland to go and visit an iron ore mine. Iron ore? Yeah.
Iron ore house.
And I went to see Santa at the Arctic Circle. He offered me a PS3 and I told him, no, I want money.
Hmm.
That should give you an idea of how long ago this was. Say like PS3, Grandpa. Oh dear. Wow, Rick's cab looking out the window of that coach. That's tall.
And yet, it isn't. Look. It's not even the same height as the coaches, I don't think.
I think it's a bit of an optical illusion.
Optical illusion.
Tell you a little fun fact, when we mentioned Sweden earlier. My father has been learning Swedish ever since.
That's a shame.
He spends a lot of time, like, you go on Netflix and find shows that are in Swedish and just sit there and watch them, and I'm like, fucking hell.
I found out it isn't my other half outside, it's my next door neighbour talking outside their front door for some reason.
It's your next door neighbours. Actually, Chris, do you have, is NK, like, as a, like, thing, does that ring any bells to you?
NK?
NK. As, like, a retail thing.
No.
Okay, never mind.
You just hear the window, you just hear dial-up sound in Chris's brain as you're talking about that.
It's a bit, Tom, you probably would know, John Lewis.
Yeah,
it's like one of them. It was
like a department store,
just a massive department store, and at the top was like all you can eat Swedish meatballs and hash.
I hope those cars are going to stop crossing the road in a minute.
I mean, yeah, fucking hell, they should have stopped by now. Stop!
Stop! You're making me yes.
To let them know you're there.
Could just fuck me.
No, thank you. I'm loving the swaying.
Yeah, man.
That is quite realistic.
What is it realistic
in
doing 46?
Your own carriage, though.
Not really. No, because the rest of the carriages are in it. There you go. Because you can't. Oh my god, that car nearly got killed.
Fork. Oh, bloody. These people are so irresponsible.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, that was a wobble.
I just realised why I weren't picking up speed. I had the handbrake on.
You fucking idiot.
Well, he's still doing 45 miles an hour with his bloody handbrake on. That's pretty impressive.
Because he's just that powerful. His handbrake? What handbrake?
Brake hand.
I have a handbrake? He is not gonna handbrake. It's just nothing. It's nothing.
I guarantee you the points are gonna change at Blue Anchor, so I'm gonna slow down there. I'll also have to slow down for Willerton, I think. But all the way up to Stogumber should be fine.
Stogumber.
Cucumber.
Cucumber? Oh. Cucumber, indeed.
I mean, we're in a freight engine doing... Essentially a freight engine. We're doing 60 miles an hour.
I think, Tom, mm-hmm. Fraser would like to know who you are today.
I am a man, thank you.
There you go.
There's your answer. Stop asking.
Actually, he's gay.
Is he, Tom? Is this
yeah,
true?
Yeah, the points are indeed going to do what they always do, I think, which is... I'm not going to pretend that they're going to stay that way, but I am going to slow down to be cautious.
The points are going to be like, fucking shit.
But he's got very powerful brakes, so he should be fine. Oh, screw me. It did take us on the right line. Okay, never mind. Let's pick up speed again.
And the gate's closed, ready for you, and everything. Brilliant. And the signal is green. You can go flat out, boy. Okay. Are these AP mark
AP
ones?
Mark ones, yeah.
Yeah, I still need to get these.
They're good.
The tidy little coaches, are they?
They're just coaches.
Are they coaches or trucks?
Trucks, said in driver. Fucks, said in driver.
Fuck. Ah, shit. Boy, that Rickus.
It's his biggest.
Your biggest Rickus.
I like how his frames have got like triangles on them, like holding them up. Like, you know, support beams. Do you see him? Above the third and fourth driving axle. Mm. And I love that. It's like, it's almost like, you know, he's got such a wide running plate that he needs a hinge in to hold them up.
Those little angle bracket things, yeah.
Because he ain't quite wide. When you think, all things considered. Memes.
No terriers on the DR.
Terriers?
No, there won't be any terriers on the DR.
Why, someone asked?
Yeah.
Yeah, terriers are small.
Small team. Teeny weeny. That's a good question for you. What engines are going to be in Gatland Junction Museum after the episode one? Because Brian and Hannah are going to be the only ones.
You'll also have the R1 probably still be in there, and Goldborn will still be in there, but I can't reveal anyone else because that'll spoil the next story.
That'll spoil the next story. Oh,
I'll spoil your asshole.
What is this? Well, Callum, this is a stream.
Is it?
Because it's Rick Day.
It is Rick Day.
Happy Rick Day.
Happy Dick Ray. I mean, Rick Day.
Happy big That's big
such a spacious cab.
Huh?
Such a spacious cab.
Oh, oh shit. Cab. Oh, fuck. Oh, shit. Fuck. Oh, Callum.
Oh.
Yes. Run, that is a big spacious cab. Run. You could build, like, you could have a bed in there and everything.
We're wobbling around.
A wobble wobble. Piscotton wobble wobble.
Piscotton wobble wobble.
King Ori, not all of them, I think, Tom? Not all the engines in the museum, private ones, are going
to
be overhauled.
No. There's only, to be fair, it's only two of them that are being overhauled.
And it's two of the best ones.
Oh, I didn't realize that Goldborn were going to be restored.
You dickhead.
But.
Uh-oh, we have a problem.
What?
I farted, that's the problem.
Oh.
Well, that's your problem. It sounds like
will
a you
Chris,
problem.
Paul, will Chris have a stream after this? Nah. Can't be bothered. That would involve effort, and I can't be bothered. I'm pretty lazy today.
He can't be bothered.
I could do a drunk live stream.
No.
I could. Really?
What's the point?
The point, my dear boy, to kill people. Wait, hang on, no. Perfect. That's what Mac and Liv do at weekends.
Oh.
Right, is this going to send me...
Oh, will any new engine be... Well, you'll have to watch and find out, I think.
I love how people do that. It's like, wait and see.
Wait and see. Wait and see.
Just fucking itch your little shit.
Callum's internet, everybody. Callum's internet.
Yes, indeed.
Uck ache. It didn't even want to make him. It didn't want to let him swear then.
Exactly.
Repair.
We can always play my favorite game when it comes to people asking questions where we don't want to give answers.
What's that?
Well, my answer would be yes.
Yes.
Next.
Your answer would be
next.
No. That's how it always goes. One will say yes, the other says no.
Computer says no.
Because the world is in a delicate balance.
Is that what we're calling it now?
A delicate balance, yes. I've got coffee. I can't watch it. Why is my internet?
Amazing. Right, we're now through Watch It. I've got enough water. Watch it.
Watch it. Going through some of the comments on the first episode, and really don't like Clyde at the moment.
I mean, yeah, no shit.
I mean, to be fair, take solace in that, Callum. People are like hard haul. It just means you're writing the character well.
Does
and
it?
You're acting the character out well.
Yes, I think characters in TVRS are probably and warrior.
Am I the only one hearing Callum lag like a motherfucker?
Yes.
It's
no.
Like, it's like,
yeah. I heard it and warrior.
Yeah, Callum, your internet might be dying.
Warrior. I'm going to go because if that won't take it, then I'm going.
Okay.
Yeah.
That bit hit me. What was your inspiration to make DR1202, Mr. Tom?
MF Paint drawings.
MF Paint drawings. Fucking around in MS Paint.
Yeah, pretty much.
Pretty much what it was, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, that is basically what where design came from.
And when is 00 gauge model getting made?
Well, when me and Gwil can work out who's gonna build it for us.
Yeah. Did you see the pictures I sent you?
No.
I sent you some pictures a few days ago, of TRS trains models that he's
he'd done like some scratch building of some, I think they were Great Eastern or something.
Right.
They're curious, but just shows you like the kind of stuff that could be made from scratch.
Hmm.
But I still think you should try and find someone to make you an O gauge one.
Mate.
Nice mantelpiece piece.
I would like that, but I don't know who would do it. This is what I'm kind of expecting you to do for me, Gwen. Helping me find someone to do that for me.
Unfortunately, I don't really even know who. It's such a complicated thing, like...
Yeah. Especially because it would literally just be pictures, wouldn't it, mainly?
Well, I mean, you've got a lot of CAD pictures to go off and stuff, so that wouldn't make it difficult at all. What I think is more difficult is not so much that, but the it's just getting parts, getting bits. Like, okay, things like the compressor and the pipe work and all that, it's not terribly difficult. People can fabricate that kind of stuff. But it's going to be the chassis, I think, is going to be a major one.
Oh, yeah, because it's a unique chassis.
Very unique chassis. Whereas, for example, the ones I showed you, they were all based off chassis that already were made. Because you just take a donor loco and use that chassis, whereas we've gone through this before, we don't really know.
It's also the fabrication of the entire shape of the boiler and firebox and smoke box and all that.
Mm.
Tender's easy, just get a morsel tender or an ROD tender.
Yep. Well, ROD, isn't it? Well, it depends. You want Rick or you want Bob?
Rick. It'll be a morsel tender. Rick. Yeah. Just normal Rick, so just morsel tender. If anybody in the comment section would like to help me build one of these in over 00 or O gauge, please get in contact with us. Please, someone, anyone. Let's bring him to real life.
That's my take on that.
Is it? Look at him just romping up this hill.
Hill. Yeah, what hill?
To be fair, this is why the Great Central Railway is flat. Everyone thought it was Brian, it was actually Rick.
It's like, you know, we talk about long engines like Rick straightening track.
Yeah.
Well, he flattens the hills as well.
Oh, mate, yeah. That's why he doesn't have a problem climbing any of them. That's what they hired him to do at Manton 4. Basically, they just run Rick up and down that way bank a few times. Flattens down the gradient a bit.
Now that's one way to flatten a line.
That's one way to deliver a parcel.
Well, I mean...
Just look at that sheer power, just like freaking thumping along. And this isn't exactly a flat piece of line, I mean it's like 1 in 92 here. I mean, to be fair, we are approaching Stogumber. God, look at that superheat header and chimney. Does this basically mean that Rick is like the ocean liner of steam engines?
No. Yes, yes.
It's like you've got... I don't know. You've got like the U-1 Garrett being like, you know, the... What was the largest ship ever built? It was like the SS Normandy, wasn't it? Like, as in, like, you know, ocean liner. I think it was either that or the, whatever. Then you've got the Element Garretts, which are more like the Aquitania. And then you've got Rick, which is, like, more like the RMF Queen Mary.
Yes, Rick went to Holland and flattened it.
Yeah, basically.
Yet another nice place I managed to visit.
What, Holland?
Yeah, I've been twice now.
You know, Tom, there's a local I just thought of that can outshine Rick quite easily.
Go on.
Smokey Joe.
Mate, Smokey Joe is hench. Smokey Joe will kill your family. And your friends. Bearing in mind the world we're in, he's climbing this hill and he hasn't even got full boiler pressure. That is hench.
I'm Super Smoky Joe.
Super Smoky Joe.
Super Smoky Joe. He just Super Smoky goes over everything. But unlike Super Smoky Joe, Rick can pull an express.
Rick can pull the killer for yogurt.
Smoky Joe can go fast, but that's all he can do. He can't pull a train properly. Hench. Hench just means...
Very strong.
Very strong, yeah. Bulky. Big. What's his name? Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's Hench.
What'd you say?
No, he didn't say what you think he said, Chris.
Don't you mean Schwarzenegger?
A nagger?
Yes.
He's a nagger. Annoying people. I know! Naggers!
Yeah. So... Here's a question for Tom, actually. And this is something I'm curious about as well.
Okay.
To Chris and Tom, on average, how long are your scripts usually?
I don't really measure length of my scripts.
Yeah, Tom writes a notepad thing.
I still write a notepad, yeah, I'm weird.
Yeah, so he just has a long thing. But I can say they're around, like, from 7 to 12 pages, because I copy them over to Docs.
And what font size and what type spacing?
This
is all arbitrary.
11 and Calibri, I think?
No, font spacing.
Font spacing is the normal, like 1.
Right, guys, we're currently doing 67 miles an hour.
Fuck's sake.
I want to see how fast we can get him to go without dying.
I will say mine are like between 9 and 15. I think my shortest script is 7 pages. So, yeah, there you go. Good luck on that. Ian's series is like 20 pages, 22 pages for his entire fucking thing. So, good luck, Ian! He's gonna kill me for that. Come on, Tom, you got this. Don't derail.
We're doing like 77 miles an hour.
Glad you could join us.
Should I risk it and push him to 80, but...
Yes, risk 80. It for a Chucky Bicky.
We've ricked it!
Oh, he's already there!
He's already at 80, yeah. Look at him fucking go!
I've lost my bearings, where are we, and is he gonna fucking flop?
We're nearly at Bishop Lydiard, but he's doing 86 miles an hour. Look at him go!
Is he gonna go into the 88. Right.
He's gonna go into the big platform, so I'm gonna, yeah.
Is he gonna flip?
I hope not. That's what I'm putting the anchors on for.
Look at that wobble.
Talk about golden wobble wobble.
Fucking shit.
What were we worrying about? He got really powerful brakes, he's fine.
This is only supposed to be a light railway, the maximum speed of 25 miles per hour.
Oh.
And he's going almost 90 just now.
It's fine. To be fair, I'm probably gonna stop the stream once we get to Bishops anyway.
Stop the stream!
Or should I just go all the way down to Norton Fitzwarren?
Go down to Norton Fitzwarren.
I'll go down. We'll go down to Norton Fitzwarren then.
Go
yeah.
Mainline.
Yeah, no.
Does it actually connect to the mainline? I didn't think it did.
Well, kind of does. but doesn't.
It gets really close.
Yeah.
Although there is a connection.
Well, there used to be. Nine, did I just hear 90? Yes, you did, King Ori.
Yes, he nearly did 90.
Oh, he could have gotten there at 80.
Yeah. He wouldn't have stayed on the tracks, but he could have gotten there at 80.
He would have stayed on the tracks. That's not like that. He's sharp.
Why is there smoke there?
Huh? Wait, what? Where's this?
Bishop's Idiot.
Oh, you're on members. You're on members.
I'm on members edition. Yeah.
Right.
Look at him go, fucking chunk.
Deja vu. I think I've seen this train before. Puffing down the line. Can we get him back up to a really high speed before Norton fits one, I wonder? Only one way to find out.
Can't wait until we can start visiting the railways again and going to Muddle Shores is what I want. Yeah, meanwhile, Chris doesn't get any of that.
No, because I'm Norwegian.
Aww.
Rory. I miss her, Rory.
So you'll need a virtual presence device.
Yeah.
You know what? He can suddenly 420 blaze it now, right? Full boiler pressure again.
Oh.
Look at him, he's already back up to fucking 70 miles an hour. I mean, Jesus Christ, look at him fucking go. We've got, I know we've got a break in a minute, but look at him go. He's like a GTI.
Fucking blazing it, mate.
Right, we are 3/4 mile from Norton.
Yep.
So, do you reckon we should break?
Nah. As soon as you hit the
if fucking I hit 80.
Bridge. No, as soon as you hit the road bridge.
No, I'm bailing.
Pussy.
I'm not a pussy. I just want to stop in the platform.
Pussy?
Oh, mate, you didn't even touch 80.
Nearly?
You were like 0.2 off 80.
Really?
Fucking two, and you couldn't be asked to push just to 80. Disappoint.
Well, we made it to Norton Fitzwarren, didn't we?
Hey,
Tom, I think you're going to undershoot it. You undershot it.
Nope, we stopped exactly where I wanted to stop.
Uh-huh.
That's an overshot.
Nah, it's fine. And just to finish off the stream, let's kill Rick.
Oh. He's leaving a train behind and he's going to go and crash now, you see. He's going
well,
out with a
bang. Well, actually, I've got an idea.
I know exactly what you're going to do.
I love that there's a triangle on a triangle.
Huh?
What?
There's a triangle on a triangle.
You're a triangle.
Wait, what? There is?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, there is! Yeah.
It's a little triangle and a big triangle.
Yeah.
Sheep. So what's your plan here, Mr. Tom?
I'm going to do another speed test on the way back and see if we can derail him somewhere. I'm not going to pick up the train, I'm just going to take him light engine.
Do you think you could get how fast do you think you could go from the other end of the triangle to here to the main line?
I have no idea.
You should see. This back as far as possible and charge it. The price to make a real life Rick, I think it's going to
be. I think you're looking at like some 9 like.
Million.
Yeah. You're looking at. You're basically what you're looking at is stonks.
Actually, 10 million. Actually, no, I think it's going to be a lot more. And you know why it's going to be a lot more?
Why?
Because with the previous locomotives that have been made recently, like Tornado, for example, they've been made off pretty much standard designs that, or based off designs that previously existed. Rick is a completely new locomotive.
Exactly.
Designed from the ground up. And all the costs into, well, I mean, there's voluntary engineering, I guess, but honestly, at the end of the day,
it's not worth building in.
You'd have to do all of the work to design and engineer him to actually
work,
make him work properly, and well, make him even safe.
Yeah.
And that would be prohibitively expensive. Could cost like 3 times the amount of it, the cost to construct it. So when Tom wins the lottery...
Mate, if... Right, here we go, everyone. The final thing we're going to do with Rick. Can we get him up to, like, a ridiculously stonks speed? On his own. For the final part of Rick Day. Let's fucking go!
Wait, you're speedrunning him.
On his own, yeah.
Oh no. Oh no.
Look at that smoke belching out of him. Smoke and steam. The thing is, I don't know where you would be able to derail him. Actually, you would actually derail him.
I'll probably derail him with Bishop's Idiot, yeah.
On that set of points coming out of it, because that was quite sharp compared to the ones going in.
Yeah.
Especially when you're going 80 at it. Could you get to 88? That's the question. Oh yeah, you can get there. Yeah, it's 88.
Look at him fucking go!
He's in the 90s now. Going through the 90s.
I think we're going to flip him at 96. Odd. In fact, I'm going to get rid of the F5 HUD any second now. We're at 96 miles an hour. I think I can see the point coming up. 96 miles an hour we got him up to on his 97 actually. Right, there we go. There we go.
Oh,
oh I love the... yes. You know what it's done? It's let me go free camera as well.
Ha. This is...
I've just got to wait for the rail sign to go and I want to get a screenshot. There you go. So, happy Rick Day, Rick. You fucked up. How'd you feel?
Fucking help me.
I got to 94 at 6 miles an hour. Does that make me a celebrity? Yes, it does, Rick. Yes, it does.
He's already a celebrity.
He's already a celebrity. He's a very big celebrity. Very big being the prime word.
At this point. You done goofed.
You've done goofed, Rick. To be fair, I am quite surprised that he's landed at this really random jaunty angle.
Is his... front bogey spun almost 180.
Yeah. And driving fine with a dirge, this is fine. Not a problem. Their engine is
what the fuck happened?
What happened? What is going on here? Anyway,
it's like that fire. It's like that video.
I love the fire.
Oh, what was that video? The fucking video where it sheared the fucking wheel off.
Yeah. Well, we're gonna do an orbit of Rick. In his dead state. I'm sorry, boy. We've gone out with a bang today for you, mate. I hope he had fun being driven to destruction over the West Somerset. Just look at him. Was that meant to be a whistle? If so, that sucked.
Fuck you.
Yeah, look at that. Look at that. He is dead. He would have caused major structural damage running on this railway, but...
He'd be fucking ill.
So, yeah, that's going to be the end of the stream. Just going to bring the camera back around to his front end, so... We can say goodbye to Rick and his derailed state. I hope everyone enjoyed the stream. I hope everyone enjoyed celebrating Rick's kind of semi-birthday. And,
Happy birthday to Rick.
Happy birthday to Rick. You're a bit of a prick, but happy birthday to Rick. Anyway. So, that's it. Thanks everyone for watching. And we will... Shush. Let me do the outro. So, everyone, thanks for watching, and we will see you all next time. Goodbye!
Penis.
Bye!